Imagine being a designer of a car. You have extremely limited resources, your boss is demanding results quickly, and you have to build it using the spare parts from all your friends' bicycles. And to come up with a working prototype as fast as you can, preparing it in your own garage. You also know it should have airbags, but you decide the chances of an accident are so low that you prefer to deliver the car quickly and make it cheaper. That's basically how the designers of the RBMK nuclear reactor worked and thought. The most important was not safety or perfection. It was time and money. And how it worked? Just look at Chernobyl. Hello guys, you have asked me to continue the RBMK miniseries. Besides doing that, I will also organize all the bigger miniseries in playlists when the time comes right, so you can have a better experience watching them exactly piece by piece. As for today, I will give you an insight about the infamous AZ5 button. I have mentioned it several times before, both in this miniseries and others. Nonetheless, it's important for you to understand how it worked. Why? Because you have probably heard about it if you're interested in the history of Chernobyl. If yes, you also probably well know that it's often mentioned as the direct cause of the worst nuclear disaster in human history. The Chernobyl accident. And that's why it's so important to share this knowledge with you, so you can understand what one means when saying that the AZ-5 was the nail to the grave of Chernobyl's Unit 4. Let's start with today's episode. RBMK History and Design, Part 8. They were killed by a button. That should save them. Last time I told you about three major flaws in the RBMK that were hugely underrated. They weren't the only ones in the USSR's proud nuclear reactor design, but the warnings were often discarded as extremely unlikely, or just discarded, due to design's goals, to be cheaply constructed and powerful at the same time. Chernobyl disaster was a culmination of those flaws. One might say that the operators were to blame too, and this isn't completely wrong. But on the other hand, they couldn't even rely on the systems they were operating. As I told you in the previous, seventh part of this miniseries, they were often forced to do the calculations themselves, as the detection systems didn't work properly. It wasn't anything unusual for the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, as well as for others like it. It was one of the flaws in the RBMK design. As you may know, in every nuclear power plant around the world, there is a procedure called SCRAM. It's basically a design of a safety system. Activated only manually, it should immediately shut down the reactor. It's done due to the rapid insertion of the control rods. The deeper they are inserted, the lower the reactivity of the fission process. So if they are inserted quickly, all at once, to the maximum depth, they should put out the fission process by suppressing it quickly. In the RBMK operating room, the SCRAM procedure is initiated by using the AZ-5 button. But there was another flaw in the RBMK design that, in the end, brought doom to the Chernobyl nuclear power plant and many people who lost their lives or health. First, as I told you before, one of the flaws was that the RBMK wasn't prepared for the rupture of the fuel channels. There were warnings stating that if two or more fuel channels rupture, there would be a huge risk to the reactor. Remember that, as it is important for the next episode in which I will explain to you how the AZ-5 button triggered the Chernobyl disaster in a way we know it now. The mechanism of this button was not designed to stop the reaction inside the reactor immediately. This was dictated not by safety, but by the USSR's needs. The designers had in mind that any usage of this scram procedure would bring a huge disruption in the Soviet energy grid. So they decided that this procedure, the last defense against the most dangerous situations that could happen in the nuclear reactor, should not stop the fission process immediately, as any event needing it was extremely unlikely to happen. The loss of power would be severe also to the whole power plant itself, not only the given unit. The AZ-5, almost in opposition to what it should do, reduced the reactor's power to zero only gradually, not immediately. Another flaw of the safety system was also an irresponsible lack of imagination of the designers. The system was driven by the same electric servos that moved the manual reactor control rods, which was done all the time by the operators while managing the power output and the workflow of any RBMK reactor during normal operation. To give you a better understanding, if you had control rods fully withdrawn, as they were in Chernobyl moments before the disaster, and you pressed the AZ-5 button, the special control rods would need between 18 to 21 seconds to fully descend into the reactor's core. You could ask, why? When anything severe happens to the reactor, every 10 seconds would be like years. This speed could mean the difference between a successful safety operation and a nuclear disaster. However irresponsible that may sound, sources stated that the designers thought that the huge number of those control rods would compensate for their horribly low speed. But they didn't think of another variable. The positive void coefficient, another important factor present in the RBMK reactors. But you may have heard that the designers knew about this safety system flaw years before Chernobyl happened. And if you did, you would be right. November the 30th, 1975, just over a year after its commission, the Leningrad's first RBMK reactor was being turned online again after necessary maintenance. But it began to run out of control. I told you about this before. In 1975 in Leningrad there was a partial meltdown, not only because of RBMK's many flaws, but also because of this particular flaw in the safety system. The AZ-5 button used by the reactor operators worked too slowly. Before its purpose was fulfilled, an extremely dangerous situation happened, releasing ionizing radiation into the atmosphere over a huge part of the Gulf of Finland. A commission was appointed to look into this accident, the first involving the RBMK reactor. Officially, the manufacturing defect was blamed as the reason behind the partial meltdown. Unofficially, the whole design was full of flaws, and the reactor became uncontrollable because of them, increasing the steam void coefficient beyond the point where operators could maintain it. There were, of course, some people who knew. The Sredmash, so the Ministry of Medium Machine Building, commission members, some intelligence officers, and a selected few scientists. Despite it being contrary to the official statement, Sredmash ordered that changes in the design should be made. But the need for electrical power rose day by day. The party officials from Moscow grew more and more impatient, and the Soviet nation demanded progress in nuclear energetics. The Sredmash orders included, for example, developing new safety regulations and redesigning the emergency system to be fast. The sad truth is that, despite those orders were given, not a single one of the changes was made. And that's how, my dear, the RBMK reactor core explodes. Thanks for watching. In the next episode, you will find the story of how the flaws in the design impacted the Chernobyl Unit 4 and drove the reactor to explosion. Since you have time to watch the previous 7 episodes of the RBMK History and Design miniseries, or rewatch if you liked it much, you will have the necessary insight to understand what exactly happened in Chernobyl in 1986. As for today, that's it. Feel free to leave me any suggestions on the next subjects, or ask a question if you have any. You can also tell me how you liked this video. I would really appreciate all honest opinions. That's it for today, guys. Take care, stay safe, and see you next week.